You're listening to the Franchise Freedom Podcast with Giuseppe Grammatico.
Okay, and welcome to the Franchise Freedom Podcast. I'm your host, Giuseppe Grammatico, your franchise guide, the show where we help corporate executives experience time and financial freedom via franchising. Very excited for our show today. Before I make any introductions, so what we did was we've been really active on LinkedIn and asking questions. You know, we read all your comments, emails. We ran a couple polls, and it was interesting to find out that, you know, we gave some suggestions as to what your concerns and questions are around franchise ownership, around business ownership. And man, funding came up over and over again. I think it was over 50 or close to 60% of people that responded came back and said funding and not knowing how to fund the actual business came up. So of course, we get your questions. We ask, you answer, just like the book. And we invited Tera Thomas on the show from FranFund. So Tera, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me again, Giuseppe. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, this is an annual thing. So yes. Happy anniversary. I think this is third time, fourth time. I've lost track.
I don't know. So I may be second or third, maybe not fourth, but I'm happy to be here as always.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna guess third, but I'm gonna double check that. But yeah, I think you have the record for appearances. So thank you for that. And Tera is my go-to for all things funding. So before we jump in, Tera, if you just want to give a little background of how you got into funding, a little bit about you, and then we'll dive in.
Sure. So my name is Tera Thomas, and I'm a senior funding consultant with FranFund, and I work with aspiring entrepreneurs to help them find the best funding strategies for their interest in small business ownership. I've been in franchising myself for over 20 years, so I worked at a franchisor level doing training and development. I've also been a franchisee, so I know what a lot of your candidates are going through and what people's, you know, nerves and fears and, you know, looking for money when they're looking to start a small business opportunity. So I've been with FranFund now for just about 5 years. It'll be 5 years next month, and just love being on this side and helping people get in and realizing their dreams of small business ownership.
Well, you have a very important role, right? I mean, if everyone's concerns, I wouldn't say I have the largest following, but we're growing. And I was just shocked to hear that. And what's funny is when we were talking before the show, you know, people are like, my concern is funding. So I followed up and said, well, what did you do about it? Did you do any research? And they said, no, it's a concern of mine. And we just kind of assumed that maybe the funding wasn't there, or we assumed the level of investment was much greater than we can afford. So,
sure.
So I thought
or they're going to walk down to their local bank.
Right. And the bank is just going to say, hey, business. Yeah, that's great for the economy. We're just going to shell out funds. And that's not the case. Right. I mean, we think it would be pretty easy. And, I will say, and I'm not going to give you the whole story, but when I started my first business, I got approved from, I won't mention the bank, who I banked with for many years, formerly banked with for many years. I quit my job, was going to start the business 30 days later. Bank said, oh, wait a second, we didn't realize you were leaving your job. And I said, I said that at the very first meeting, full transparency, I'm leaving my job. And they pulled the loan 30 days prior. And I did not know back then of all the options, and did not have the guidance of someone like myself. So I ended up having to take a family loan, which was not thrilled about. So it's good to, the moral of the story is it's good to do your homework early and make sure you're covered. And I didn't have a fraction of the access to the resources we have today. So with that all being said, that was a mouthful. I was going to cover updates for 2023, but since we last spoke, it was probably around this time, episode aired around September of 2022. Not really much as far as updates, which is fine. We don't need updates every year. So wanted to, for all the new listeners, kind of go through, and maybe we start off with, before we talk about what services or product, maybe talk about how FranFund functions. So someone that does have a question about funding, what is it that you, what exact service do you provide? What does that look like? Is there a cost? Maybe we'll start there.
Sure. So FranFund is located in Fort Worth, Texas, but we work with clients all across the country. And we were the first funding provider that offered multiple funding solutions under one roof. So the things that we do in-house, Giuseppe, we do help our clients to obtain SBA loans. We offer a loan consultation service. So we're not a bank or a direct lending institution, but we work with a very large network of lenders that we've been able to educate on the franchise opportunities and brands that we work with. So it's typically just a little bit, you know, easier than if somebody were to walk into a local bank. We also have some fleet leasing programs, and we facilitate the ROB strategy. ROB stands for Rollover for Business Startup, and that is a program that allows people to use eligible retirement savings and invest them into your business without any income tax or early withdrawal penalties. And it's not unusual that people use a combination of these strategies, you know, and it's not unusual to really what we try to do is, again, have a conversation. There's five other funding consultants or five total on our team. So it really just starts with that conversation. What is your goal? What are you looking for? Is an SBA loan going to be a good fit? Is it going to be ROBs? Is it a combination? Maybe you have a large amount in marketable securities and it makes sense for you to talk to your wealth manager about a portfolio loan. Maybe you have a ton of equity in your house and it makes sense to consider a home equity line of credit. So again, we're really going to talk through all of those strategies, what makes the most sense for you. And then we don't do any unsecured lending in-house, but we do have an unsecured lending partner that we work with as well, if a referral out that way is good. So again, it's just making sure that as you realize what business opportunity, how many territories or how many units, what is your long-term goal, making sure that you have the ability to get there.
I love that. And it's a holistic approach. It's similar to our approach in that I want to buy a McDonald's. I want to buy a certain franchise. Well, let's take a step back and what are you looking to accomplish? Right. Why? Because sometimes people are looking for a specific product because they read about it, not realizing there's so many other franchises, so many other funding options. So it basically, it's similar to our process where there's no cost for the initial consultation. You're able to really figure out their why, because their why and what they're looking to do also affects the funding strategy, right? I mean, if you're looking to start off with five territories and then add another five territories or complement that with an additional brand down the road, there may be one strategy versus it's one and done. I'm just looking to buy the initial. So,
or like you said, maybe they're planning on leaving their job to start the business. And if there's no other household income, if they're not married and there's no other spousal income or other types of income, then that might rule out one type of financing versus, you know, doing a ROBS or something like that. So it is really kind of getting all of that information on the front end, you know, where we talk to people that maybe they're moving to start a new business. So they're in the process of selling a house and buying a house and all of those things, you know, kind of factor in. So we're really looking at that overall picture.
Right. I like it too, because some people will make, we were talking about this before we started recording here and said, well, if I speak with Tara, she's only going to be able to show me a couple options because they only have a couple options in house, or not a couple, more than a couple, but whatever options they have in house. But it sounds as if, and from the feedback I've received, you're able to even suggest options outside your wheelhouse. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. As I mentioned, we have an unsecured lending partner. So maybe somebody has got really good credit and good income, but they don't have the cash injection, you know, the cash liquid that an SBA lender will require. Or maybe it's a smaller investment than SBA lenders might not be interested in. We'll provide that. You know, it's not often, but we do have people that are even, you know, overqualified for an SBA loan, believe it or not. Some people are always shocked to hear that, like, what? You can be overqualified. But if, you know, if you have maybe typically about more than three times a total project cost in liquid assets, meaning cash, savings, non-retirement stocks and securities, and you're probably overqualified for this government-backed loan. And that's where you might say, you know, I might say, hey, look at a securities-backed line of credit or a portfolio loan. So again, you know, and sometimes it's a combination. So we're looking at those types of opportunities and options all the time.
And there's lots of pieces to that. And I will say, and we've worked together for a while, so you may qualify in all ways, but then we do a little digging and find out the credit score isn't where the lender is comfortable with. So, you know, I always suggest, and correct me if I'm wrong, to discuss funding earlier in the process. I usually recommend after we speak the first time, either after that call or by the second call, have that introduction, because in the event, maybe some credit repair needs to happen. That's not an overnight thing. It takes a little while. What are some time frames with some of the an SBA loan versus a Rob's plan as far from start to finish?
Sure. So just to kind of piggyback on what you said, though, there, 2G, we don't do any like credit repair in-house, but we do have some people we can refer you out to. So it's been amazing, especially over 5 years now, how many candidates I've spoke to that weren't really ready that first initial conversation. I said, hey, let's work on the credit a little bit. Let's increase your cash position or bring on a partner. But it's really telling them what they're going to need to do to get there. And they come back 6 months, a year, 2 years later and say, okay, I did those things. Now let's talk again. And then we get them approved for an SBA loan. So it's really, like you said, it's really about being consultative and educational. So people know what they're going to have to do. If the time isn't right now, then it might be right in the future. And now I just talked and I forgot what your actual question was.
No, that was, I mean, that actually, while we're actually, I wanted to touch on that because that to me is a huge plus. And I think that's what makes you and your company different. It's not just, you're not approved for the SBA, you know, have a great day. You're not going to get approved at this point. With that being said, let's put together a plan. What is missing? All right. The credit score is there, but it could be overqualified, right? Which is, you have too much cash, too much liquidity to invest. But usually it's the opposite. So maybe you don't have enough for the cash injection. So what are the numbers needed, right? I always reverse engineer it. If you need 50,000 and you have 30, you got to get to 20,000. Once you're getting an additional 20,000 liquidity, once you get there, let's have that conversation. Sure. And I think that's what makes your company different in that you're proactive in helping people. Obviously, if you're recommending someone to help them with their credit score, that's just a referral recommendation. That could take some time, and that's a little bit more difficult. But there's a plan. There's a follow up strategy instead of saying, "I'm not approved. I can't buy a franchise." End of story. So I really appreciate that, and that goes a long way because some people don't have an idea as to what exactly they need to fund a business.
Well, and what I remember though now too, you were talking about the timeline. So I think, you know, early on is pretty good. You know, if somebody is pretty well financially qualified and they know they have some liquid assets and maybe some retirement or equity in real estate and good credit, they're pretty comfortable, you know, maybe they can wait a little bit longer. But if you're kind of like, I'm not even sure what the funding options are, I don't know if I'd get pre-approved, then have the conversation early on. Our initial conversations are all no cost, no obligation. There's not even a hard credit inquiry to see about a pre-approval for an SBA loan. Mm-hmm. So the only thing it's going to cost you is a little bit of time. And if you are looking at franchise opportunities, as Giuseppe can tell you, you know, once you get far enough in the process and they're going to invite you to a confirmation day or discovery day, they typically want to know, how are you going to fund this? Whether that means, here's my bank statement and I can write a check, or I'm going to use my retirement, or here's my pre-approval letter. So it just helps you to feel comfortable too, knowing, okay, these are the opportunities that I might be able to consider. This is maybe the total project cost or range that I should look into. We do have charges for our services when and if clients do engage. So for our loan consultation service, it's a flat fee when and if somebody engages with us for our services. And then it's the same for the ROB strategy as well. We have a flat initial upfront fee. And for that strategy, there's some ongoing administration fees because we're creating a real retirement plan that is utilized by the new business.
Love that. No, you covered, actually, you covered some other questions. You beat me to it. I'm looking at most of them like, wow, she's going through it. I'm glad you brought that all up because I always say be prepared. And what do you have to lose? It's literally time. The check, soft check, not affecting your credit. It's not costing you anything. And actions speak louder than words. Everyone asks me, and it's almost like they don't believe me, telling the franchisor, yes, I have plenty of funds, or at least being proactive to say, these are my financials. And not only are these my financials, but this is also a pre-qualification, goes an extremely long way as opposed to saying, yes, I can get access. I have a wealthy uncle or aunt that's going to send me the money. Yeah. It's not really going to go too far, but that the pre-qualification, and it is so simple. And how quick is that? Is that pre-qualification normally?
Yeah. So typically within a couple of days of filling out our preliminary application and talking to one of the lending specialists on our team, we're able to give you a reliable yes or no. So the pre-approval process is very fast.
Gotcha. Perfect. So the one, I guess not concern, but pushback I get is when I recommend speaking with you early in the process is, well, we haven't even talked about franchises yet. We'll talk after we look at the list of franchises. And my response is always, well, you know, at a very high level, your financials aren't changing. Obviously we want to see if you can maybe afford this larger project or this brick and mortar location. So what do you say? Because sometimes I'll say it and they'll say, yeah, okay, it makes sense. And maybe they don't reach out right away. So what advice do you give?
Yeah. So I don't think it's ever too early to have a conversation with like a funding consultant on our team. You know, sometimes we don't move you into the actual preliminary application process until you've maybe narrowed it down to two or three brands, because it can kind of vary depending on if it is service based versus brick and mortar, if it's multiple units, if it's multiple territories, depending on what the franchise fee. So all of those things come into play when you're getting pre-approved for an SBA loan. It's not like a similar to a mortgage, but not where you just say, okay, Giuseppe, you're approved to buy any house up to $500,000, because it can vary depending on those franchise fees, territories, brick and mortar, those things. But, you know, we've all been doing this, you know, our funding consultant team has, and I'm the oldest on our team, so I'm not saying this in like.
You're the oldest? Wow.
It's a young team. It is a young team, but we have over 50 years of franchise experience between the five of us. Probably closer to like 55 or 60 now. So, and I say that like, we're not that old people aren't wonderful. But we're not a bunch of grandmas and grandpas that just happen to be like, that's not one person that's been in franchising for 40 years. It's just right. All combined we do. So we can give you a really good idea on that initial call. Like, hey, you're a good candidate. You might want to stay in this 2 to 250 range, or maybe they don't have collateral to offer, so they should stay beneath a certain range, or not do brick and mortar or something like that. So we can give you that idea up front to give you that confidence to continue the investigation, or say, you're a little light today. You know, you're going to need to save or bring on a partner. Right. So you're not spending time, you know, continuing with them, and they're not spending time that they don't necessarily probably want to spend in talking to franchisors if they're not going to be able to afford it. So it's just getting that upfront conversation. Again, all it's going to cost you is time. And then if we say, yeah, we think we're going to have some options and you found a couple opportunities of interest, then we move you into that preliminary application process, which is also no cost and no obligation. So it's just like we follow the path kind of like you do in your consultation services, Giuseppe. But what I'll tell you, and you've seen the same, I have some clients that I talk to that they're like, oh, we're going to Discovery Day next week. And we've already done this, and you know, they might move very quickly and engage in our services within a couple of weeks to a month. And I have other clients that I've talked to for 6 or 9 months, right? Because I stopped talk to them very early on, and they've just started their discovery and their investigation. So, you know, it's checking in with them every couple of weeks or whatever that looks like once they've really narrowed it down. So everybody's a little bit different, and there's no right or wrong way to do it, except if you don't have the conversation of funding at all, and then you get too far and have no option.
It's going to hurt your chances, because what happens? You get invited to a discovery day, you get approved, and you're like, okay, great. We need to know within a couple of weeks. And you're like, all right, I'm going to get pre-qualified for my SBA loan. That's not going to look so great, especially that, you know, that could take, depending on what's involved in that loan, could take months and months. So, you heard it from Tara. You know, I'm sick of saying it, guys. I keep saying the same thing. So you're hearing it directly from the source. This is day in, day out. You're having these conversations, and you're making business ownership a reality for people. And but it's also just like my job is, let's figure out your skill sets and what you enjoy doing. And it's a way to and the type of ownership. If you want to be semi-absentee or full-time and that kind of thing, we're funneling, getting very specific as far as brands we're looking at. And on the funding side, same exact thing. If your intention was to look at brick and mortar your loan amount is $100,000, that may be an issue. So we need to go back, obviously, depending on what you're putting down, but the project cost is much lower. So we want to make sure that we have all that in place so that we are looking at companies that fit the model, fit the funding options, because what's the use of looking at something that is just out of your reach on the funding side? So what else?
Another step in the process.
Yeah. What's that? I'm sorry.
I said just another step in the process.
That's it. If you follow the process, it's again, you know, it could be where, okay, I really want this type of business. Great. Maybe it's something we have to hold off on and make sure we hit these requirements. Touching on the Rob's plan, because I've been getting a lot of questions there. So with the Rob's plan, you know, not everyone is qualified for it, right? And I want to talk about this, because this comes up quite a bit. So they hear about it, they don't listen to the whole episode, or they just kind of heard a friend tell me, I use my retirement, and they'll come to me saying, I have $1 million stashed away in my 401k, but I'm with the same employer. It's all with that employer, and I'm going to continue working. So, you know, what are the kind of the qualifications for the Robs, and what, who can use their retirement money?
Yeah. So anybody can, you know, unlike a loan where you have to have a certain credit score and cash and collateral, possibly, you know, income, there's no qualifications for the Rob strategy. So credit does not come into play, collateral, income. However, only certain plans are eligible for the strategy. So I think, you know, that's pretty much what you're saying when you qualify. Right. It's a real short list of what is not eligible versus what is. So as you said, Giuseppe, most employers do not allow you to access your current retirement savings while still employed. So if you're with your current employer and you're not planning on leaving immediately, most likely you cannot invest those funds. Now, sometimes people change employers and they're rolling funds in from a previous employer. Some employers will allow you to roll out what you rolled in, not trying to get too deep in the weeds, but just so you all know. And then very specifically, Roth IRAs are not eligible for the strategy. So if you have a Roth IRA, it is not eligible. So it's really any type of previous employer retirement account. If it's a 401k, a 403b, 457, a thrift savings plan or TSP from the military, or maybe you combined all of your previous employers into a rollover IRA, any and all of those plans would be eligible for Robs.
And how would they check if they stay with their employer and they want to check, who do they actually contact for that?
So they call whoever the custodian is for their retirement plan, the administrator. So if it's like the Fidelity or John Hancock or, you know, Charles Schwab, whoever administers their retirement plan, they would call them and just ask, you know, can I roll my funds out into an IRA while I still work here? And that would kind of give the answer of whether or not they can access it while still employed.
I like that.
A majority of employers do not, but if people love the strategy, I always tell them it's worth the phone call. Just like we're talking about, you know, it's worth the time to spend with FranFund. It's worth a quick phone call if that's something you're interested in.
So what was the question? The reason I'm asking that is because some people say, well, I don't want to cause any red flags because now my employer thinks I'm looking to start a business.
People are always worried about their, like, well, I don't want my employer to know. So your employer doesn't have to know. So yeah, you bring up a very good point there, Giuseppe. So the way I tell my clients to ask, because that way they don't mention Rob's, because they might not even know what you're talking about, to be very transparent. You don't have to mention I'm thinking about leaving or starting a business. Just say, hey, I want to roll my funds out into my own IRA. Maybe you have a friend that's a financial advisor, you know, can I roll my funds out into an IRA while I'm still employed? That's a simple way to do it. And they will say yes or no. And or you can say, how much can I roll out into an IRA while still employed if you happen to roll in funds from a previous employer?
Gotcha. See, I'm learning. See, I didn't know that. And that's why you're the expert there, because that was a concern that's come up a few times. So that's awesome, because obviously no one wants to cause any red flags. And obviously, if you are employed, you need to check your employee handbook if you can have a business and employment as well. That's something we cannot answer. You need to go back and find that information out.
Right. Super
helpful. So yeah. So the moral of the story and the point of the show is there are options. There are options, outside of kind of things I learned about over the years. I had no idea about, portfolio loans, using kind of taking a loan on your non-retirement accounts, home equity lines of credit. And to Tara's point, there's no better, or in my opinion, or I shouldn't say better, right or wrong, or I will say better, because it has to be, you have to be comfortable with it. Some people have the mindset, and I worked on Wall Street, and at the time, I admittedly said never touch your retirement. But knowing what I know now, well, I'm in the stock market. I have no control on the investments. Why not bet on myself and use those funds to start a business? So
And without getting like too into the weeds on Rob's, for people that may not have heard about it before, because you're right. And I get that all of the time. I get a client and I'll tell them, I'll see that they have a large amount of retirement savings sitting there. And they're like, oh no, right. I'm not touching my retirement. And I'll just ask why. And I know that sounds kind of like, and they'll be like, well, because I just had somebody yesterday that's earmarked for retirement. Absolutely. But this is still earmarked for retirement. Right. So I think what you have to realize is this, the Rob strategy, you are not taking a loan. You're not cashing it out. You're not taking a distribution. Basically what you're saying is that, hey, instead of investing into Google or Oldsmobile stock, I want to invest this money into my own business where it can continue to grow. So we've seen so many of our clients that will use retirement savings and invest them in their business, have that business for 5 or 10 years, while paying themselves salary, wages, bonuses, and sell that, business for 4 times what they invested. And that money goes back into their retirement plan pre-tax, and they made a great investment. So, I don't think anybody's going to move forward with a small business opportunity, no matter how they're funding it,
right,
if they don't think there's going to be a good return on investment, right? That's probably everybody's goal, and not working for somebody else, but, having some good income come in and have a good return. So why not invest that money into your business? And again, with what the stock market's done in the last year or two, going up and down, just so many people are feeling more confident about investing that money into themselves.
Love that. What was a typical turnaround for something, assuming, obviously there's variables there and paperwork, but what's a typical turnaround on a Rob's plan?
3 to 4 weeks. It's also like pretty much the fastest means to funding outside of writing a check if you have your cash sitting there.
And the SBA, SBA loans, what would be a reasonable turnaround?
Sure. So after a loan has been submitted to a lender, assuming if it is brick and mortar and there's like a LOI for the commercial real estate, you're probably looking at about 45 to 60 business days.
Oh, it's actually better than I anticipated. I thought it was.
Sure. It depends. I mean, a lot of things, like if you're looking at, if there's specific licenses that are required to operate, or again, getting general contractors bids and letter of intents and leases done. So, a lot of things come into factor there, but yes.
Yeah. So with the brick and mortar, right, you have to have that location, and that's going to take time. So,
yes. So a lot of times people, when I say that, but then if it takes you 3 months to find a location, then obviously, that loan package isn't even submitted to a lender until you have that letter of intent.
Gotcha. And life happens, right? So when you're working with somebody and all of a sudden things change, and a couple examples, a partner comes into play with a cash injection where they still need funding, but maybe they're looking at a larger market, or they end up losing their job or leaving their job earlier than anticipated, potentially accessing the Rob's. This is an evolving thing. So there can always be changes. It's not like it's set in stone. Situations change, investments change. So you're able to assist them, should life change.
Well, and that's kind of what's nice about working, with a funding provider, because we're kind of that go-between the bank. So instead of going to the bank and maybe saying, oh, this is what happened, we're going to reassess your situation to see how we can, still move forward, how we can show the bank that you're going to have income, or how to kind of present it to a lender in the best way possible. And, sometimes if something large changes in your life, there might not still be possibilities, but I mean, things change all the time. Like you said, life happens, and that's where we're going to help you to know how to present that to the lender in the best case possible, so we can hopefully still get you that SBA loan.
Awesome. So you guys need to speak with Tara. Tara, I'm going to put everything in the show notes, but what's the best way to to reach you should someone have a question about funding?
Sure. People are always welcome to email, call. If anybody is interested, you can go to franfund.com. That is our website, and right there you can request a free consultation with somebody in our team. So all you'd have to do is submit your name and email, and then somebody on our team will reach out to you. Well, it may be me. I will tell you, our team is fantastic. So no matter who you talk to, you're going to get the same great customer service, and we'd be happy to help.
I will vouch for that. When you were out the other day, team was awesome to respond and never had an issue. And for anyone that we're working together with, I'd make an introduction directly to Tera. You'll have all access, email, phone number. We'll put that in there as well as the live calendar link. So definitely encourage you to at least take a chance, you know, put together your financials. So that's a good thing to do. So kind of your homework assignment for today is really, if this is something you're considering, start putting together, not figuring out the products and what's the best option. You're going to work directly with Tera and FranFund to assist, but put together your financials. You know, what's your cash liquidity look like, your investments, retirement, put that all together. Home value, mortgage, get that all updated. It's good to have that information. Anyway, I keep it monthly. I do a monthly update on a spreadsheet. Yep. It's a good practice to have, maybe not monthly, but we'll say quarterly. But and that'll definitely help to prepare for your first meeting. So Tera, I wanted to thank you. This has been awesome. If you're cool with it, we'll maybe continue with the annual check-in. And absolutely, unless something happens that changes sooner, we'd love to have you back on sooner. And thank you again. I really appreciate it. I learned something new every time.
You're welcome, Giuseppe. I'm happy to come back annually and sooner if needed, if the funding landscape changes.
Awesome. Thanks again, Tera. I appreciate it. Take care.
Have a good one.
Thanks for tuning in. Whenever you're ready, here are three ways Giuseppe can help. 1, if you've ever considered owning a business of any kind, you owe it to yourself to get a copy of Giuseppe's book, Franchise Freedom. Download your free copy at ggthefranchiseguide.com/book. 2, want to understand how successful executives make the transition from corporate to owning their own franchise? Join Giuseppe's next online presentation, Franchise Freedom: How to Escape the Corporate World and Have Financial and Time Freedom by Owning a Franchise, by going to ggthefranchiseguide.com/video. 3, want to work with Giuseppe one-on-one to identify the right franchise opportunity for you, to navigate the process, and get plugged into experienced franchising advisors? Send him an email to gg@ggthefranchiseguide.com with one-on-one in the subject, and he'll send you all the details.